Hello, hello, birthdays and anniversaries. We love to sing to you if you've had a birthday. Looky here, looky here. Who? Emily Weaver. Come down here, lovely lady. Liam and Gianni, fine looking. Patrick, what a good looking bunch. Ron. And Judy, yes, I see.
when you fell, when your birthday, when you...
Oh my goodness. Sharon Lee, Larry, Emily. What a good looking bunch. Judy's having her party tomorrow at the hospital. They're going to do open heart surgery on her, and so I guess that's her party. Maybe no cake, I don't know. All right. Caleb, this is a fine... is your birthday? How about anniversaries? All right, a good looking, I'm telling you. It couldn't get no better. Here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Only one mountain. Born again. Birthday.
Thank you today. And I do want to start out by thanking all of those who helped serve yesterday. We had conference here and had a great time. I had our ladies here and men, and they served. We had a great service. So let's give them all a hand, all them who served food and worked this weekend. It was a long weekend, but it was a blessing. So we thank them. Especially good to have you here this morning. If you're visiting with us, this is your first time with us, if you've never been with us before, we want to welcome you especially. And if you just hold your hand up, our ushers in the back have a gift for you today. If you've never been with us before, just hold your hand up, and we have some over here. Give them a gift bag. They're going to give you a visitor's card if you will fill that out. Got some over here. Fill out that visitor's card and put it in the offering bag. We don't want you to put any money in the offering bag. We just want your information. And listen, today there is a Korean dinner being served, and you're visiting. You get to eat for free. Amen. How many first-time visitors we have now that you know you get to eat? Look at that. Boy, look at all those. I've seen you for 30 years, but you're a first-time visitor. But we'd love to meet you, and so good to have you today. Hope you feel at home, and we'd love to see you at the lunch right after service. Good to be in the Lord's house today. Stand together, and Ron will lead us in a number this morning.
Part of the blessing of being a Christian is joy unspeakable. Page 167, and then boys will put it on the magic screen and sing with all your heart, and we'll praise him in song. Are you happy? Yeah, half a dozen. Over here, a little happier on this side, I think, maybe. But anyhow, sing with us with all your heart. Here we go.
I found it, grace is all complete, he supplieth every need. While I sit and learn at Jesus' feet, I am free, yes, free indeed. It is joy.
Joy, I'm speaking.
lead it joy. Ask the ushers to come, sing on the last again. Talk about joy. I found the joy no tongue can tell. How its weight of glory grows. It is like a rain.
Judy will be having surgery tomorrow morning, open heart, so let's remember her, especially in prayer. Brother Johnny, would you pray for us?
Oh, Greatest news in the history of the universe, Jesus saves. Man, that was good. Your favorite.
They sent for Jesus, your friend's about to die, but
about that old time religion.
like to talk about the time of his coming, when I see his sweet face in the cloud. And if you're talking about that old time religion, then I know what you're talking about.
And if you're talking about that old time religion, then I know what you're talking about. About the kind that will make you love your neighbor, when old Satan will say turn around. About the kind that will comfort you in sorrow and never fail to make you shout. And if you're talking about that old time religion, then I know what you're talking about. And if you're talking about that old time religion, then I know what you're talking about.
Well, we had a good Sunday school lesson this morning. Lord really, really just kind of snuck right in there and sat down with us. It was good. A lot of people sharing testimonies of things they've gone through and how people encouraged them. And good to have Jared back. He had a rough couple weeks. The Lord helped him. Larry's here and Judy's here, and I'm sure there's others that are here. And we're glad you're back. We're glad the Lord's met your need. And just thankful for his blessings upon our lives. Has he been good to you this week? Amen. F.
Now this Christian life, it's not always been easy. Oh, I've had days that I've asked the Lord why. 'Cause I've seen the heartaches and the pain of some loved ones till it seems
we
he's doing when I'm somewhere between.
Turn to Proverbs chapter 3.
I didn't want to say anything, but you think that, you know, I come in here all jolly, but before I came to Florida, I was angry at God. I asked him why he brought his son, because we're nothing, and I wanted to die. Last 40 days has been a pure hell. We lost our brother. And then 2 days before I come to, I had to put my 16-year-old dog down. That he was everything to me because he was my companion through some very bad stuff in my life. And I said, God, why would you do that? Why would you put him down 2 days before I have to leave? I told Tracy, I said, I can't go, Tracy. I can't do this. And then I talked to Chris. I couldn't talk to nobody physically. I could only talk to Tracy physically, but I would text Gail and Christine, and I didn't want to come. And I was mad. I was so mad. And I said, just let me die. Why don't you just let me die? And then I talked to, I have a wonderful church and two wonderful pastors. And the one, I said, you know, I said, the one thing is the pain. I can't stand no more pain, the pain. And when I think about, I mean, I would holler at my house. I would scream. I'd be so mad. One of my pastors I talked to, and he said, you know, Stacy, what God has given us, he gave us animals to show us what it would have been like before the fall and what it should have been like. And he said, because of the fall, we all must have died. I've just been so stressed, and I've cried so much. My husband and I have cried so much that he's sick, and I didn't want to leave him. So I got on the plane. I didn't want to do it, and I've cried so much. I don't think I've ever cried so much. Not because of just a dog being put down, but everything that was happening. My brother died. I just can't take it. You know, my daughter had been 10 years strung out on drugs. So bad. And I was coming to visit her here. She, of course, she was in prison. She come in and out of prison. I was done with this. I said, Lord, I've asked you and I've prayed, and I believe what you say when you say you bring a child once you shoot drug. They might depart, but they will come back. And I said, I'm banking on that, but it's not happening. Well, when the last time she got out of prison, she said, Mom, you know, you always told me, you know, trust in God. God will help you. And she said, I'm sick of that. When you're a drug addict, you don't want to hear that. And then she said, when you told me that you got mad at God because you didn't understand why he wasn't doing it, she said, something happened to me. She said, because I always thought that, you know, you would never get mad at God. God is so holy. God is so wonderful that he was too much to get upset with. She changed, quit doing drugs, and now she's clean. But, you know, the pain, I can't stand this mental pain. And so this morning, I'm up, and Tracy and I are listening to music, and I'm not in pain right now. I hope the nighttime is the worst time for me. So I'm coming here, Jolly, you would never think what I was going through. You'd never think that I was begging God to please, please let me die. So what I'm trying to say is, you know, God is good. I mean, and when you sing that song, God is there, God is right. Yeah. You know, I didn't think that. I'm like, I'm done, you know. But I thank God. And my brother died. He had two children, Rebecca and Jason. Rebecca came to church and she got saved. She's living the life now. And she used to be a drug addict, but she had quit. But she's now got God. Her fiance was a very, very harsh man in his life. He's done a lot of things. He said to her, I'm going to watch, see how you do. And last week she said, I caught him. She said, I couldn't find him. She said, I caught him downstairs reading the Bible. My Bible. So he said, I might go with you. So, I mean, I know things are good that happens. I know, you know, things have to happen. We all are going to die. Unless the Lord comes, we all are going to die. Now, where we go, now that's something. The thoughts of, you can't understand eternity because our minds can't understand it because we don't know. But eternity is so much, this is a vapor. And even when we call this a vapor, it's not even a vapor. It's a fleeting moment. And when you spend eternity either in heaven or hell. So, you know, I'm glad that the Lord's helping me. And, you know, my pastor says, Stacy, you're sitting here asking God to take the pain away, but yet you are not wanting to go to Florida for your family to love on you. and to help you and be there for you. So he says, you can't sit and wallow. He says, you got to go. You got to, God is trying to help you. You're just not letting him. So I just, you know, I love the Lord. And I, you know, whenever the, my time comes, I'm going to heaven and I'm washed by the blood of the Lamb. So I thank God for that. And you know, you can be mad at God. It's okay. You know, people say, you better not be. You know, you can because we're human. You're human. But God loves us so much that that's nothing to him. He wants to help us to get through it, you know. So I thank God for saving my soul. That the devil can't take your salvation away. Now he can try to rob you of your joy, and he tried. So I thank God that he is my father, my protector, my lover. I love him so much. He's my dad. And I thank God that he, you know, I told Tracy this morning, I said, you know what my mother did for us? I said, my mother gave us something that through God, that only we can have is that all my brothers and sisters, we love each other very, very much. So I thank God for them. And I thank God that we were raised in church. And I thank God for saving my soul.
Amen. Proverbs chapter 3. You glad to be saved this morning? Say amen. Proverbs chapter 3, I want to look at this morning the two most important words for the Christian. The two most important words for the Christians. No, it's not, let's eat. Amen? You have heard these words since you were in Sunday school. You've heard preachers remind you of them. Maybe you've heard a friend quote this verse. You've probably listened to testimony after testimony, and this verse was spoken. It's been heard on the mission field. It's been heard as well at home. Wherever it may be, you've heard these two words. And the two words are these. Trust God. Trust God. God. Two simple words that you've heard hundreds of times, but you will discover as time passes how difficult they are to obey. Trust God. Now, the reason these words are so hard to obey is because you and I have no idea what the future holds. None of us do. And you may lose your home, you may lose a loved one, you had a dream, you had a hope, it never came to pass, and all these losses are painful. But we must bring ourselves back to the words found in Proverbs chapter 3. Are you there? Say amen.
Amen.
We're going to be looking at verse 5 and 6. And when you see them, I know, you memorize them in vacation Bible school. Or you memorize them when you're in Sunday school or when you were growing up as a small child. But what I want you to see is that there is a positive to this verse, and then a negative, and then a positive again. First, the positive in verse number 5. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. There it is. That word, trust. You know what that word, trust, what it literally means to trust in the Greek language? That word means to lie helpless, face down. You ever been there? Something happens to you, something breaks your heart, and you find yourself helpless, face down. Well, listen, you might not know, but that's a good position to be in as we seek to put our entire trust in the Lord. That's the positive. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Now the negative. This is tough. And lean not to your own understanding. See, the caution here is that we don't try to figure everything out. How many know you don't have all the answers to life's problems? And you may never find out all the answers. And how many know Google does not know everything? You as a mortal, you cannot know the ways of God. So quit trying to figure them out. It just becomes more frustrating. The positive, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. The negative, and lean not unto thine own understanding. Now back to the positive. But in all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he might direct your path. Aren't you thankful for the word of God that it ever changes? And he shall direct thy path. Did you notice? We're to trust with all thine heart and in all thy ways. Trust God. Now, if we're honest, we have a problem with this because of several things. A lot of times, we're just too self-sufficient. We try and we learn how to get ourselves out of jams rather than acknowledging the jam that we're in has very well either been directed or permitted by our sovereign God. I got to hear Warren Wiersbe speak one time, and he was preaching on life, and he kept saying this: life is our school. You're in school right now. Life is our school. And he kept saying this: heaven, our graduation. So while we're here training and learning and being educated, we must trust God. Another reason we don't trust is because maybe we feel distant from God. By the way, you're not alone if you feel that way this morning. So did Job. You remember Job? As godly as he was, and yet Job said, in the midst of all the loss, though he slay me, yet I will what? Trust him. Though he might take me off this earth, though I'm going through that process, I am going to trust God. Another reason we don't trust is because we have faith in what worry has to say about it. You hear me? Many of us are better at worrying than we are at trusting. If I asked you right now, hey, get out a piece of paper and make me your worry list, we'd go right at it, wouldn't we? Filling out, flipping that paper over. Hey, can I borrow your paper? I need some more. It'd probably run circles over any other list that we'd make up. And you may be worried right now about something. And although there's not one thing you can do about it besides give it to God, we decide we're going to worry about it and fret and toss and turn. Because that'll solve it, right? I love what one guy said. He said, worry is like a rocking chair. It gives you something to do, but it doesn't get you anywhere. Amen? And we worry. Why do we worry? Because we lean not on our own understanding. Listen, if you think you're going to outgrow the problem of worry, think, if I can just reach that certain age, all worry will be gone. I'll conquer it. Ask our seniors here this morning. You won't ever outgrow worry. You might do better at it. Through experiences, you might do better at it, but you won't outgrow it because it's a battle you will have with your flesh the rest of your life. Paul says the flesh fights against the spirit and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to the other until you reach the age of 72. Is that what it says? No. For the rest of life. And you'll fight it just like you will pride, jealousy, lust. You never outgrow them. It will always be there to battle you. I remember watching a chapel service at Dallas Seminary. It was an elderly missionary, 87, 88 years old gentleman. He was brought up to the platform. They had to help him up there. And he leaned on the pulpit and he spoke on fighting against the flesh. And at the end of his message, they had a Q&A time, a question and answering time. And one of the questions was, sir, when did you conquer lust? That old man said in a gruffy old voice, well, brother, it hadn't happened yet. Listen, you'll never conquer worry. It's part of the flesh. all you want to. But the only way you'll get through it, so that you'll learn from the testing, is to trust God. I put worry on hold. I set it aside. I shove it away and say, God, at this very moment, I rest in you. I give this to you. I was thinking this week, last night especially, about Brother Ken Shamlin and Sharon Lee. They've been through it. Do you know what? I've watched many times Brother Ken come up here and sing, I thank God for the mountains. And I thank God for the valleys. And I thank God for the storms He brought me through. For if I never had a problem, I wouldn't know that God could solve them. I'd never know what faith in God could do. But how many of you can say this morning and testify that through it all, through it all, I've learned to what? Trust in Jesus. I've learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend, not on my words, praise God, upon His word. Amen. Trust God. Can I give you a list this morning about whether you're trusting God or not? When you choose to worry, you do not trust. When you try to fix what is impossible to fix, you do not trust. When you hurry ahead and you don't wait for the Lord to move, you're not trusting. When you lie awake, twisting and turning all hours of the night, you do not trust. When you begin to doubt biblical principles and promises that are right here in the book, the Word of God, that you and I love and cherish, we do not trust. You see how easy it is to live in the flesh? See how easy it is to disobey this command? Trust the Lord with all our hearts. Today and this week, I want you to think of ways you can begin to trust God regardless. Ask yourself, what is it I'm going through right now that's keeping me from trusting in God wholly? And how can we break that habit and watch God break through in ways we never could have expected? So I want to tell you something this morning. When fear seizes you, all your ability to think rationally evaporates. Life becomes overwhelming. The promises of God are just thrown out the window. Brother Chris Rollins preached one of the best messages I've heard him preach yesterday. I'm telling you, that was amazing. It was encouraging. And he talked about this when Moses sent the spies into Canaan to gather information for the people of Israel. You know what happened? Fear of the looming giants became much more visible than any of the blessings that Canaan had to offer. Although they obediently gathered fruit from the land, their report focused on the seemingly impossible obstacles they were about to face. In Numbers chapter 13, verse 32, the spies exaggerated and gave the worst report possible. You know what they did? They compared themselves to grasshoppers and claimed that the land would devour them. And this fearful exaggeration infected, get this, it infected all the other Israelites around them. You know what they began doing? They began crying and grumbling against Moses and Aaron, and it even led them to claim, I wish we would have just died in the wilderness. You know what happened? Israel forgot God's promise in verse 2. God said, send out the men that they may search the land of Canaan, which I have given unto the children of Israel. How many know the Bible says we walk by faith, not by sight? Children of Israel were walking by sight and not by faith in what God had promised them. So how do we trust God fully? How do we fight off fear? Understand, when fear begins to creep in and all the what-if situations begin to consume our mind, I want to give you five things we must remember. They're not long. They're going to put them on the big screen. Give me 5-10 minutes. We'll be done. Five things to remember as we fight off fear. Number one, the first thing we must remember is God's truth. God's truth. Is what I'm thinking about really happening? Or is it just my imagination running wild? I love what John Piper says when they ask about the fear of death. He said, I am immortal until God's work for me is done on this earth. The Apostle Paul said it this way in Philippians 4, verse 8. Finally, my brethren, whatsoever things are true and honest, whatsoever things are just and pure, lovely and of good report, what does he say? Think on these things. Be thankful for God's truth. Number two, be thankful for God's presence. Listen, you can be comforted today knowing you're not alone. You can be comforting knowing God is right there with us. David said in Psalm 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. I love what he says in Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou wilt heal me. Is that what he says? For thou wilt save me. That's not what he says. He is fine as long as God is what? With him. God's presence. To know that God is walking right beside you every step of the way, that we don't go this alone. Thank God for God's presence. Number three, we must remember God's grace. Child of God, this is so crucial. You know, the more severe your trial becomes, the more grace God showers upon you. Well, you ought to thank God for that today. God promises to provide us with his all-sufficient grace for every trial that comes our way. Remember what he told Paul? Paul asked three times, Lord, take this from me. Lord, take this. I don't know about you, but if I want something taken, I'd be asking 300 times. He only asked three times. But what did God say to him? Paul, my grace is sufficient for thee. And he says this, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. You know how Paul responded to that? He said, most gladly will I now glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest on me. Are you thankful for God's grace, the grace of God here today? God's grace. Number four, remember God's sovereignty. This is important. Child of God, God is in control over every situation in our lives. Did you hear me? God is in control over every situation in our lives. You see, the wonderful truth of God's sovereignty is that not only does God know where you are right now, he knows where this is leading. You don't. We know the past. We're feeling the present. But you know nothing beyond this second. But understand, none of that affects God's will. None of that affects God's plan in all of this. His will is taking place, your personal trial included, right now. If he wished for it to be different, it would be different. He doesn't. Therefore, what you're going through is exactly what he planned for you to go through. And so I rest in Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. Claim that today. Do you know that is a promise you are to claim? God is sovereign. You are not. You don't understand, but He is in control. Isaiah 55:8, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than yours. One writer put it this way. He said, we focus on the immediate, but God focuses on the ultimate. God is in control of your situation right now. And number five, God is listening. God listens. Talk to God. Tell God how you're feeling. David said in Psalm 40, verse 1, I waited patiently for the Lord, and He inclined unto me, and He heard my cry. Pour out your heart to God in prayer. Five things to remember to help fight off fear, anxiety, worry in our lives. So the question is, will you do that today? I hope you'll trust in the Lord with all your heart, and you'll lean not unto thine own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. There was a man who was raised with three of his brothers in Southwest Texas. He was brought up on a very poor ranch. Could barely make a living, but once their age of 18, that the father said, if you want to leave, you can, and pursue your own life, whatever you want to do. And three of those four brothers, they left the ranch. They couldn't wait to leave. They couldn't wait to make a living any place else but that old ranch. In fact, all three of the brothers left ended up making a very nice living for themselves. That one brother, he stayed behind. He stayed with his father. He didn't want to leave. Yeah, it was a poor ranch, but he loved that ranch. It was his dad's ranch, and he continued to help at the struggling ranch. Years later, his father died, and of course, the ranch was left to him. He didn't want to sell it. It meant too much. So he began to develop it and cultivate it as the other brothers, they continued staying away, making their living. So he and along with his wife, they really turned that ranch around into something successful. Crops began to grow in abundance. And they sold them, making a good living. He had cattle and he bred them and sold them, horses and sheep, you name it. He ended up becoming more wealthy than the other three brothers combined. But in his testimony, he said, then came the fires of 2011 to Southwest Texas. He said they swept through the entire area. After a few days, he said the fires had gotten very close to our ranch, and the man and his wife, who had worked so hard, they knew they were going to lose all their cattle and their property. So they made a decision. They decided we're going to open up all the stalls and all the gates, let the animals go. And amazingly, he said, those animals seemed to know which direction to go to find safety. He said off they went. Every animal he owned, hundreds of them. Husband and wife also packed what little they could, got in his truck, and he drove away to safety. He said a few days later, they were allowed to enter back into that territory. They came back home and everything was gone. Everything was burned. Everything was melted. Everything. He said even the metal roof on the barn had melted down. Everything was a total loss. All my possessions, all my pictures, everything gone. He said all we had was a tent. We set it up in the back of my pickup truck. Stayed on our property that night. He said, boy, it was a sleepless night, not knowing how they were going to make it, knowing everything was gone. Man said, I woke up the next morning, and he and his wife started looking through burned debris, looking if there was anything that could be salvaged, anything worth saving. And he said, I looked up and I couldn't believe what I saw. He said, off in the distance, I could see something coming my way. Not just one, but hundreds. Since it got closer, I started hearing the moos of cows and the neighing of horses. And he said, would you believe almost every single animal we own did not die in the fire, but they made their way back to our property. And they all clustered around an enormous burned up oak tree. He said, you want to know why they came around that oak tree? He said, because around this particular oak tree, every single day, I would meet with them. And I would feed them. And I would water them. And I would brush them down. And I would pat them on the head and speak lovingly to them. He said the fence was entirely gone to keep them in. But the feeding troughs all burned to the ground. But here they all were, gathered around the oak tree. The old farmer said, these animals had more trust and faith than I did. For they knew if they could just get to that spot, there they would find their master waiting for them. And once they found him, they knew he would care for their every need as he had done before. And some of you are there today. Your hopes, your dreams burned to the ground. Your children are away from the Lord. Maybe a spouse is unsaved. You have a health issue. You have finance issues. Maybe your marriage seems all gone. But can I tell you something? As long as you know where the Master is, you can trust him. And he will meet your every need as he always does. So are you trusting in the Lord with all your heart? Or are you leaning on your own understanding? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You're here this morning. You'd be honest. Say, there are some things in my life I'm fearful of. I have anxiety. I worry. Maybe it's a family member. Maybe it's a marriage. Maybe it's your home. Maybe it's your kids. It's a health issue. Whatever it may be, I have something. And I'm not trusting in the Lord with all my heart. I'm leaning on my own understanding, and I don't want to do that anymore. You'd be honest. You'd say, that's me today. There's something in my life. God knows. You just slip your hand. Bless all the hands. Hey, the altars, some have already come. Why don't you come and bring it to them?
Yeah,
trust the Lord. Bring it to him. Drop it at his feet. Give it to him. In all my ways, I'm going to acknowledge him. And he'll direct my path. How many have lost loved ones, lost children, a lost spouse, lost family, you want to remember in prayer? You ought to bring it to them today. Dear God, I pray this morning, there are so many here who have needs. So many here who need you to show up in a special way. So God, we're not going to trust in anything else except in you. I'm going to trust God. Why I'm here, I do not know. But I am in your will and I am walking in your will and you're going to lead me. So God, I pray for all the different ones who raise their hands. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed, you're here this morning and you've never been saved. There's never been a time you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Would you just slip up your hand by that saying, pray for me. Pray for me, I'm lost. I've never been saved. Would there be one? Bless those hands. You need to come today. The altars are open. Would you come? Give it to the Lord. We love you, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. As we stand together, some have already come. Would you step out? Would you bring it to the Lord as we sing?
Sing with us. Jesus. 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 There.
church come forward.
Yeah.
Say a few words.
I just want to thank everybody for their prayers and the food that was brought to the house.
Yes.
It was certainly appreciated. Thank you so much, everybody.
Yes. God bless you.
Everybody be praying tomorrow. She goes in for
open
heart surgery. I have quite a few announcements, so we're going to go through them tonight. We will be meeting